What is the best camera in 2019 and what camera would I buy if I would break the camera that I use today? Ciao, mi chiamo Benjamin Jarvoski, sono un fotografo paesaggista. And this was Italian, and today I give a shout out to all Italian viewers and watchers, because this is my international channel, and I want to say hello in each language of all the people that are watching this channel. So today, shout out to Italy! Okay, so what is the best camera in 2019? I thought about that last year when we did the video in the 2018 edition, because if I would break my camera today, what camera would I buy? What is out there? So I give you an overview. And it's pretty interesting because in the 2018 video are almost total different cameras like in the video today. So if you haven't watched the video of last year, watch it as well. There were many cameras that came out in 2018 and those cameras are now in this video, of course, as well. But if you watch the video at the end of 2019, there might be some other cameras out. So wait for the 2020 video. All right, let's start. So the first camera I would take a look at if I would break my camera today. Oh, wait, what camera am I using today? I'm using the A7 R2 today. I use it since 2.5 years, I think. And yeah, it's still working, it's still fine. I think I would buy it today again, but maybe I would take in consideration that I take a newer camera and another camera as well because of some features, and you will see it in this video. But this is just my personal opinion. Everything that I'm saying in this video is just my personal opinion. What I would suggest you is take the information I give you, go in a camera store, take the camera in your hand and look at the features that you are interested in, because I shoot landscapes, I film videos, I do not that much of portrait stuff, I don't do weddings, I don't do whatever stuff, so maybe you do total different stuff. So what is important for me is maybe not important for you. Let's start. The first camera I would take a look at is the Nikon Z7. 3,600 euro body and adapter. And that is quite funny because you can buy it only with body and adapter. I did not see any body only purchase possibility. And that is because the whole mirrorless thing, and this is a mirrorless camera if you don't know, a lot of people thought that they could just use their old Nikon lenses they own on the new mirrorless Nikon. But it's not possible because they are built different. The sensor is on a different place in the camera. That's why they need a new mount. And the new mount is also bigger by Nikon because of the huge megapixel, I think, or I actually don't know why it's bigger, but it's different. So you either need new lenses, the Z lenses, or you need the adapter and adapt your old Nikon glass. But there's plenty of glass out on the new camera. So what camera is it? It's a mirrorless camera, which I think is important because I want a mirrorless camera. I don't want a DSLR anymore. It's a full frame camera, which I like as well. It's mirrorless, as mentioned already, 45.7 megapixels. So quite a lot of megapixel, more than I have today in the A7 R2. It has 9 frames per second continuous shooting. So yeah, not the best for wildlife, but not that bad as well. It goes up till ISO 100-2000. It has a 5-axis sensor stabilizer. So it's quite cool for filming handheld without shaking, or taking images with a longer lens without shaking and all this stuff. It has a touchscreen, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, USB-C. It can film video 4K 30 frames, and it can film full HD 120 frames per second, which is quite cool. So what I see as a pro in this camera is it has the 5-axis image stabilizer. I have it here as well, and it's quite cool. I don't want to miss it anymore. So if I would buy a new camera, it should have the 5-axis stabilizer. It has a very good electronic viewfinder, what I heard so far. It has the 8K time-lapse mode, which is cool, but you can do it as well with just any camera when you just do images and then put them together in a program. What I would see as a contra is it does not have a flip screen. You can tilt it, but you cannot flip it around. The battery life should not be that good with that camera, which is a bit sad because Nikon had plenty of time to see what Sony did wrong in the past and could just develop a better battery. That would be a solution, but they did not, so battery life is not that good. There are not that many lenses for Z mount available right now, and you only have one SD slot. And of course, the price, €3,600 for the body and adapter, is quite a number. But when I take in consideration that I don't need that many megapixel, I could check for the Nikon Z6. It only costs €2,500. It has a full frame sensor, almost the same features like the Z7, but it only costs €2,500. So it's quite cheaper and you get almost the same, but less megapixel. The next camera that came out last year, also mirrorless camera, also full frame, is by a big player. It's the Canon EOS R. €2,500, body only. It's a full frame camera, it's mirrorless, 30.3 megapixel, so quite a lot megapixel as well. 8 frames per second continuous shooting, a bit less than the Nikon. It has ISO 102,400 as well, just like the Nikon. It has the flip screen I like so much, and I want to have it on the Sony as well. I loved it on the 600D. I had a 600D plenty of years, and I loved the flip screen. Because you can flip it around, you can do vlogs, you can see yourself, you can go on crazy angles, and you can see what you're doing. The Canon made it. That's very good. It has a touchscreen, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, USB-C. It can film video 4K 30 frames as well, but only cropped. So that's kind of a small issue, I would say. Full HD, 60 frames only, and it can film HDR, full HD video, but only in 30 frames. Not bad, but not that good as well. So the pros for the Canon EOS R: it has the flip screen, which I like a lot. It has a fast autofocus, which I did not mention yet, but it should be very fast. You have to use an adapter as well. That's a contra. There are not that many EOS M, I think it's with the Canon. There are so many mounts now out, it's crazy. But with the EOS M, there are not that many lenses, but you can adapt with an adapter as well, the whole EFS mount thing from third party manufacturers, from Canon itself, and so on and so on. It does not have body stabilization, so it won't have the sensor stabilizer, and it only has one card slot as well. The third camera I would look at, and a lot of people recommended the camera under the 2018 video already, but the camera was not out when we filmed the video last year, so it's out now, and it's a pretty amazing camera. It's the Sony a7 III. It costs €2,250, body only, with the kit lens. I think it's 28 to 70 or something. It costs €2,380, so not that much as well. It is a full frame mirrorless camera, 24.2 megapixel. It has two SD slots. It has a 5-axis sensor stabilizer. It has HLG 4K HDR. So it can film 30 frames per second, 4K in the new format. It's like lock, but better. So it's HDR format for filming. And it can film in 4K 30 frames without cropping. It has full HD 120 frames per second. It can photograph 10 frames per second continuous shooting, and that noiseless. I don't know if the other cameras can do it noiseless. It was some feature they advertised, that's why I know it. And it has a touch as well. And that for a price for €2,240. What are the pros? What are the cons? I would say the pro is the good battery life, because they improved the battery. It's now a bigger battery in the Sony, and they have very good autofocus. They improved the autofocus with the a7 III as well. So I tested it against the light, I tested it in low light and everything. With the native lenses, the E-mount lenses, it works pretty nice and pretty good also while filming. The video features are amazing, so you don't actually need more. All I wish for is 4K 60 frames on full frame, but what it has is pretty cool. Two SD slots, but what I see on the negative side with this camera, I had to look a bit for negative things, because it's actually a pretty amazing camera, and it's the third generation of mirrorless for, let's say, a good price by Sony. They have the 7, 7.2 and now 7.3. But what they still don't have, what I hate when I get the new camera, they don't have a charger. So you get a new camera, but you don't have a charger with it. You have a cable, and you can plug the cable in your camera with the battery, and then into the plug of the wall, but what's that? And if I imagine I would break my camera today, which is the 7R2, and I have the old batteries, and I have the old charger for the old batteries, and I have to get new batteries then and new charger as well, then the price of 2,250 euro goes a bit up. And what I wish for, and many people wish for since years, is a nice flip screen, because it only can do it like this, like with the 7R2, and I want to have it like this to the side. But yet not, but maybe in the future, we'll see. But those are the negative things. If you say I want more megapixel, then I would choose maybe the A7 R3. It has almost the same features like the 7 III, but it has more megapixel. It has 42 megapixel, but it costs then as well 3,299 euro body only. Quite a price. Okay, and the last camera is the Fujifilm X-T3. It costs 1,500 euros, so it's the cheapest camera of all the cameras we have here, but it's only an APS-C camera, but if you don't care, full frame or APS-C, that should be fine. It has 26.1 megapixel, 11 frames per second continuous shooting, ISO 12,800, and it has half of a flip screen, because it can do it like this, and it can flip to your side, but not on the other side, which is a bit strange, but at least half a flip screen. It has USB-C, it has two SD card slots, it can film video 4K 60 frames, but with 1.18 crop, and it's also cropped because of the APS-C, but at least 60 frames. 4K 30 frames is possible, Full HD 120 frames as well, so that's quite cool. So what I see in the Pro for that camera is 4K 60 frames, and price value, 1,500 euro for 4K 60 frames with a nice APS-C sensor and two SD slots. That's pretty amazing. And half a flip screen. What I see as a contra is it does not have the sensor stabilizer, so there's no stabilization. And yeah, I like stabilization, especially when I'm filming. Imagine you film with a longer lens, 70 to 200 because of the nice look, and then it's all shaky, shaky, shaky all the time. Then it's nice when you have the sensor stabilizer, and when you want to adapt lenses that don't have image stabilization in the lens, you can use your sensor stabilizer. That's why I like it. Okay, 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 many, many great cameras, but what of the cameras would I choose? Maybe you can write first what camera you would choose, or what camera I forgot maybe in all of the things I've told you now, but then the video would be 1 hour long. But you can write in the comments below, and amongst all comments, I will give away one of my learning courses at learnfromben.com. Quick commercial. If you want to learn more about photography or filmmaking or image editing, go to learnfromben.com. This is my website, and there you find the download courses on your computer where you can learn your specific skills. And the course I'm giving away today will be my Easy Learn Landscape Photography course. We filmed in the beautiful landscape of Norway, all the essentials about landscape photography, especially for beginners, and therefore you could definitely use the cameras I talked about. So yeah, good luck with the comment. And now let's talk about my choice. What camera would I buy today if I would destroy my A7 R2? I think I would go with the A7 III. Why not the A7 R3? First of all, I have a lot of Sony lenses, so I would not go for Nikon, and I would not go for the Canon, I think. The Fuji is not interesting for me, only if I would do only filming, but I don't have any Fuji lenses, and I like the full frame stuff, especially for night photography and everything, so A7 III. I think for most of the things I photograph, 24 megapixels would be enough. I photographed now for 2.5 years with 42 megapixels, and there were very little situations where I needed the 42 megapixels. But there were many situations where I thought, why is my machine so slow? Why does it need so long to process the image? But on the other hand, if I would say in the next years I want to go more into printing, and I printed in the last 2 years big images, and I laughed when I printed that I had the 42 megapixels. But yeah, it's hard to say. So if money would not matter, I would take the A7 R3. And for filming and for all the stuff that I usually do, I think I would go with the A7 III. Yeah, I think that's my thing for 2019. So let's see what will be in 2020 when we see us the next time here in the video. Subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. Write me your opinion as mentioned already and win some nice course at learnfromben.com. And yeah, I see you in the next video. Bye bye, and go out and take some nice photos.